First of all, you have to have the structural integrity in place, the structural principle, and that is you've got to make time to talk. If you don't have time to talk, you're not going to talk. So at least 3 days a week, I want couples to have 30-minute couple talk times.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
John, today we're going to talk with Dr. David Clarke, one of my favorite guests. He's like this deliverer of gold nuggets, or the way I like to think of it, anything wrapped in bacon. He just delivers. You know, you can wrap anything. You can wrap asparagus in bacon and it tastes good, don't you think?
I would agree with that, yeah.
Bacon. Well, that's what we're going to hear today, some great marital advice from someone who is funny but very insightful.
Now, Dr. David Clarke, Mr. Bacon, is a psychologist, a speaker, and an author of numerous books. He wrote, Honey, We Need to Talk, and that's going to be the basis for today's conversation.
Well, Mr. Bacon, welcome back to Focus on the Family.
Gosh, thanks so much. The blonde's going to call me Mr. Bacon now for months.
When Jim gives a nickname, it does tend to stick.
It does.
So.
I'm sorry. Boy, I think in O'Hare Airport, they sell chocolate wrapped in bacon. Now, that doesn't even sound right. I've not tried it, but there you go, John.
Well, your point is good, though, because David does bring some great energy and humor, and he really does bring insights that can help us in our relationships.
Well, in fact, David, you open your book, Honey, We Need to Talk, which is a great title, by the way.
I think so.
Most every couple would say this is true. Even if they talk a lot, they might not be talking about the right stuff, right?
Women love that title. Men aren't so sure.
Yeah.
But men don't buy books, so who cares?
That's basically it. But you talk about a humorous story right from the get-go about marriage, your marriage, and miscommunication in that marriage. I think it revolves around soap.
Yes.
Which, when I read it, I was howling because this is exactly Gene and me. What happened?
It's the sliver of soap. We had a deal early in our marriage. We used bar soap, which everybody should use. Body wash is a waste of time.
We're trying to teach our teenagers that.
I know it. So we used the bar soap. The deal was when it gets down to a sliver, as we all know, you can't use it anymore, and it becomes a real problem. Well, the deal was when it gets down to a sliver, if you're left with a sliver, it's your job, even if you're in the shower and you're wet, too bad, that's life. You walk 10 feet to the closet, and you get the new bar soap, and you replace it. Well, one day, Sandy didn't do that. I knew the last time I took a shower, it was going to be a sliver. It was going to be her job. Sorry.
How do you determine the sliver?
Yeah. And is this in the prenup?
It's scientific. I'm a master of that.
Yeah, you get it down to just before sliver.
Right. So, but she didn't replace it.
Yeah.
I thought, okay, two can play at this game. I'm not replacing that sliver. Not my job. So I used that sliver. And then I went to shampoo. I was using everything. I was not going to replace the bar because it was the principle of the thing. I didn't say anything to her. I'm going to beat her at her own little game. That went on for 2 weeks. Finally, I said to Sandy, you've got to be kidding me. You win. Why didn't you replace the bar of soap? She said, you dummy, I started using body wash. I haven't used that bar of soap for 2 weeks. I said, you're kidding me. Why didn't you tell me you did that? Of course, it was my fault. It's always my fault.
Well, that one sounds kind of like your fault.
Thanks.
I'm just saying. But it's a great illustration. I mean, Gene and I go through that same thing with the bar of soap. We don't have rules, though. It's just like, you know, replace it. But it seems like I'm always the one digging under the cabinet looking for that new bar of soap.
I'll bet you are. And that's not right.
I need to check to see if she's using body wash. Maybe that's true. There's so many bottles in there. Who knows what's going on?
Women have a sea of stuff. I said, I couldn't tell. It was all shampoo.
Oh, that is funny.
How does this lead to communication? I'm still
kind of
wondering.
I'm thinking we're in trouble right here. We might as well sign off. Thanks for listening.
There's got to be a point in here.
Well, there is a reason that you wrote this book. What are you saying with the thousands of couples that you help, especially in this area of communication? What is the breakdown when it comes to communication? I would think most of our marriage counseling that we do now out of Branson at Hope Restored, the communication issue is the number one issue.
Oh, it's absolutely central. We think we can talk on a deep level and an insightful level before marriage. That's not true. You're infatuated. I have a rock in my shoe becomes an incredibly insightful statement. I like Bugs Bunny. Gosh, so do I. I mean, it's ridiculous. Once you get married and you're living together, it all breaks down. And we don't know how to talk on a deep level. No one ever taught us how. If Mom and Dad did it, it was behind closed doors. We've never seen an intimate conversation between anybody, typically before we get married.
Well, and when you talk communication specifically, you're talking about intimacy.
Right.
So when you look at it, back to that kind of question, what is the secret to intimacy? What is it? What are we missing in our marriage communication that is the secret? Is there one thing?
There is one thing. Dr. Clarke always has the secret.
Okay. That's why you're here.
Exactly. You want the secrets. It is being able to tell the truth as a couple about practically anything. There should be very few topics that are off the table. Because if you can't talk about a topic, that's the topic that's going to kill your relationship. I don't care what it is. Parenting, finances, in-laws, sex, money, whatever.
Okay, why do we, as married couples, why do we retreat to hiding?
Scary.
What's happening?
It's too scary. And what happens is we have an early in the marriage, we have a topic that we don't do well on. We can't adjust. We try to talk about it. It doesn't work. She gets upset. I withdraw. And so we stop talking about that topic. We kind of maneuver around it. But the problem is that topic is going to end up killing us. And it ends up spreading out to other topics. And pretty soon, I don't want to get upset about that. That's not going to work. And so we don't talk about almost anything on a deep, serious level.
And in fact, in your book, Honey, We Need to Talk, you mentioned clam and crowbar as an analogy between men and women, which I was howling. I don't know, John, if you caught that.
It was a pretty good one, wasn't it?
I mean, what do you mean by clam and crowbar?
In every relationship, there's a clam. Now, it's usually men. Men are clams, women are crowbars.
Okay, explain it quickly.
The clam is someone who doesn't like to talk on a deep level.
Okay, so they clam up.
Clam up. I'm clamming up. I'm not going to give you the insights, the personal things. I'm a man or I'm a woman. I wasn't raised that way. It's not my personality. And the crowbar wants to get the clam open. That's why I married you. Not just for your wonderful physique. That was part of it. But I want you to talk. I want us to share life. And so this becomes a battle early on in just about every marriage. Talk to me. No. But pressure. I try to pressure you. I won't talk.
Okay, talk about the crowbar. Typically the female, you're saying, but not always, but typically the
typically.
Female. She that sounds a little more aggressive, crowbar.
It does, but it's the truth. This is the woman who doesn't replace the bar of soap. I'm just telling you.
It all goes back to the bar of
people
soap.
Think she's
so we're
nice.
Back to the soap.
I'm sorry. People think she's nice. No, she is nice. She's a wonderful person. She's more expressive. She's a woman. So by nature, she shares and wants to share. She wants these deep, intimate conversations with her man. That's why she married him. And she tends to, she can't settle. The guy can live 45 years, 50 years and die without ever having a deep conversation. He can die with a smile on his face. Doesn't get it. The woman can't do that. It means everything to her. So she presses, she asks questions. How do you feel? What happened today? And she doesn't get the response. She's not getting the deep conversations.
Right. So typically in the courtship, that seems to be flowing pretty well.
Oh,
in the pursuit mode.
Oh, yeah. She thinks she's got it. She's sure of it.
Why do men clam up after the marriage vows?
Because we married you. Game over. I've killed the deer. The head is on the wall of my den. I'm done. It's like the competition is over. But what really happens is, the truth is, he was never talking in the first place on a deep level. He's never done that. Some of these conversations, we can talk for 2, 3, 4 hours. When you look back, there's been some research done, not much, but some. And when you look back, those conversations aren't really deep. Infatuation reigns, and they're not actually deep.
So did God wire us for this blinding impact of infatuation?
He is that did.
What is, he knew what was going to happen after
yeah,
he
wants people
yes.
to get married, basically. So that will do it.
Yeah.
If we knew the truth before marriage, there'd be a lot less marriages. I hate to say it because it's so hard. But the good news is, you can have the breakthroughs.
Well, in fact, you point to 4 steps to finding a solution specifically to the clam crowbar problem. Go through the 4. What are they?
First of all, you have to have the structural integrity in place, the structural principle, and that is you've got to make time to talk. If you don't have time to talk, you're not going to talk. So at least 3 days a week, I want couples to have 30-minute couple talk times. No kids. Above all, no kids. They ruin your romance. They ruin your communication. Always about the kids. We put them in bed. We lock them in if we have to. Sandy and I did that for years. Different story. No dog, no pets. No electronic devices, private, just the two of you. How many couples do that? It's in the single digits. Mm. That's why communication is such a problem. So we create the time to talk, 30 minutes.
3 times a week.
3 times a week. And then typically I'll have the crowbar who's going to talk more, and that's fine. Let's say it's the lady. She starts talking and sharing about whatever she'd like to share about. Now here's the key. She's going to share in 2 categories with the clam. First category is I'm going to throw a bunch of stuff out because my mind is filled with a bunch of things and I don't forget any of them. And I'm just talking and sharing. And the first category is, honey, whatever you want to respond to, your choice, if something strikes your fancy, if it's interesting, you want to continue that conversation, you do so. Up to you. Potpourri. A banquet of possibilities. The other category is, okay, honey, I'm talking about something very important to me. It's personal. It might not seem important to you. It is to me. I want you to respond to this.
And to cue him for that.
Men don't have a clue. Everything right. seems important to the woman because she's waving her hands and she's excited about buying the loaf of bread for half price. Well, is that important? I don't know. It could be. So...
Okay, I need to say, though, there's no woman at this table, so we need to defend women, too. So I'm going to play that role with you. So
please,
sometimes yes. it isn't.
You got to wave your arms as you do that,
Joe. Oh, but please. That's good.
If I'm only our up, listeners baby. Could see us now. But okay, so that's one. And two, try to create this two separate approach.
Right.
And be forthright as the crowbar, if that's you. Predominantly women will be in that modality.
Right. Yeah. And there's no pressure. Let's say tonight is Tuesday night and we're having one of our talk times, the first one of the week. The guy's not going to respond to anything tonight. He's a man. He's got to process it. Other than yes, or I like what you said, or I'm interested, or he's reflecting. He's not going to have a personal response. You married a man. Very unlikely. That's why we have the second and third talk times. If he'll process and write some things on a pad and kind of, it has to be intentional, he'll get back to you the next time. Now, I'm going to have some response the first day, but even if there's a response, it's not going to be super deep. We have to talk about that same topic, and that's the third thing. We have to talk about it again tomorrow if it's a good topic.
Okay.
We're going to get deeper the second time.
So step two is introduction of the topic, no response. Step three is time to respond.
Right.
Okay.
Right. And so, and that's, most couples don't do that. We talk about one topic, one time, that's it. Even if it's a decent conversation, it's not deep. It cannot be deep. Who's got 2 or 3 or 4 hours anyway? You're giving 30 minutes. And we're not made that way. So the second time you talk about something, hey, I was thinking about the movie, thinking about your mother, thinking about one of our kids, thinking about that topic, I have something more to say. It's something more to say that gets you deeper.
Okay, so for the guys, just even hearing you list those four things right now, I kind of went, whoa, that's exhausting.
Oh,
I mean, so how do we
tough.
Overcome that quick knee-jerk response to tune out? How do we stay in tune, especially in the exploratory discussion where it's all over the map and it really is fatiguing.
Oh, it is. I'm giving men a huge break here because the woman may want a response to everything she says. You can't do that. Life's too short. Why do men die 8 years before their wives? Because they want to. That may be edited out. Anyway,
and it may not. You're in trouble.
Who knows? No. Because we can't take all that. But now in my system, we're changing it to you decide what you want to respond to. Unless I tell you, this is important to me. I need to have a response.
Okay, so that's three of the four. What's that fourth step in the four-step process?
Well, the fourth step in my mind is centered on the man, whoever the clam is, and they have to be intentional. They have to then remember what is said, reflect what is being said, so there's a connection, and then the things I'm going to respond to, I do have to write down, or I'm going to forget them. If I'm a clam, I will forget it by tomorrow. I'll forget it 10 minutes from now. I got to jot this down. See, love is intentional. It's not just, gosh, we're in love. Our relationship is the greatest. We never work at it. Nobody has a relationship like that after you get married. So I have to be intentional. Can you imagine? We've had this experience, the blonde and I. When I come back.
That's your affectionate term for your wife.
Yes,
Mrs.
my wife,
Clarke,
Sandy. Yes,
whom we've never
yes.
met. But
Mrs.
We hope
Bacon
someday.
To you. Anyway.
Mrs. Bacon.
Can you imagine? I come back to our second talk time in the week. I got things written on a pad that she's mentioned that I'm interested in. And I say, honey, I've thought about some of the things you said. Here's some of my responses. She goes crazy with love and respect. And you thought about me. Women love to be thought about rather than I got nothing. I don't know what I'm talking about. I forgot what you said. So we got to be intentional.
So when you look at the number of couples that you have counseled, how many of them kind of are diagnosed in this arena where the guy says, I have nothing?
Just about 100%.
Yeah, so this could be one of the core problems in marriage and certainly marital communication.
Oh, I think it's huge.
That we're not active in the process as men.
No.
And when we pull back, women get all the more crowbarish, if I could say
exactly.
that.
And the men have to believe, and I try to convince the men in my therapy offices, I know you love her, you die for her, but you're denying her one of the most important needs in her life, and that is sharing yourself personally. We got to find a way to get your clam open. I do love her, but the way, we're changing the scenery here, changing how we do it, and that's going to work. And the benefits are awesome. She will love you. You'll love her. You're closer. I will throw this in for the men because they're interested, and it's the God's truth. It's going to improve your physical life like you wouldn't believe.
Mm. Yeah.
Now I have Mr. Bacon's attention. He's like, oh. And so that's not the point. That's a secondary thing, but everything works. And a woman is made in such a way that if when you love her and you're open to her, she will give the love back 100,000%. 1,000%. It will just flow back to you.
Interesting. You talk in the book also about what to talk about. Because men are that lost normally.
Oh, clueless.
We don't even know what we should be talking about in this moment of intimacy, these three 30-minute sessions per week to move everything, all the distractions away, kids and animals and everything else, and actually really communicate. So coach us along. What should we talk about in that moment?
Every couple says to me, and mostly the clan, they'll say, the guy will say, I'm sitting there with my wife. Panic sets in. What am I going to talk about? Sir, don't worry. She's going to talk. She will start many of your conversations, and that's okay. We just covered that whole area, and you're going to reflect, and you're going to show interest, and you're going to respond to certain things she says. And then we have the carry-up. So she'll carry many of the conversations. She'll start many. That's okay. As long as you respond to a certain percentage, now we have a dialogue. You're talking, and we're okay. The second thing guys have to understand, it gets back to the pad, and this could, you could use your, most people use their phone for this, obviously.
Taking notes, you're saying.
Exactly. Yeah. But when I go through my day, if I'm doing my job, now I'm a paper and pencil guy. I'm a dinosaur. I have a flip phone. That says it all. Anyway, I like that. Like John Johnson, you can flip it open and you can flip it shut. It's just impressive. Yes. Nobody seems to be as impressed as I think they should be. But so I go through my day. I'm now going to share some original material. I'm not just going to bebop off of what Sandy says. I'll do that because she's got a lot of material. But she wants to know, what are you going to bring to the table tonight? And so I go through my day and I jot down things I think would interest her. Events. If I have a strong emotion, I had an interaction at the budget counter yesterday that was not pleasant, all right? And I got through it. I tried to be like Jesus, and it wasn't easy, but that was something we talked about last night, Sandy and I. Anger and this and that. That's something that she wants. That was part of my day. Not a big deal.
She wants to hear that you were angry.
Oh, she does. Oh, yeah. Or really happy or disappointed, or women are into emotion. So if I have it, most men would just bury that and move on. I know Sandy wants to know about that.
Yeah.
So I'm going to share that. If I'm on top of things and I'm stressed during the day and that was a stressful thing, something else happened, I jot that down and I'm going to share that with Sandy when we talk. Last night I was on the phone. That's fine. Long distance. But when I get home, there'll be a whole list of things with my trip with Focus that are interesting. I had a great time with the counselors yesterday. Larry, the book guy, our time, you know, a lot of stuff that I'll be jotting notes. And I'll be sharing that with her, and she'll be thrilled. You thought about me. This is your life. If I don't do that, typical guy, I go through my day, I got nothing. I'm asked, how was your trip to Focus? I don't know. Are you kidding me? Or what happened today? Nothing. That's what most men say, that you can't build a conversation on that. But men have no memory. Don't trust your memory. You don't have one. If I jot things down, she's impressed. I have material, and I can now start more conversations. That's good because men get tired of the lady always talking.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? Start talking yourself and you can start to balance things and it will go the other way.
Sometimes, David, the relationship has gotten to the point where maybe even that talking is, there's a barrier there where she's shut down.
Yeah.
And so you have two people shut down and the communication isn't happening. What can a couple do to ignite that once again if they've been clams toward each other?
I choreograph their talk times. Of course, the couples I see in therapy, it's exactly where they are. They're done. They're seeing me because they're thinking of getting a divorce, and it's total shutdown. We don't talk. We don't make love. We're just co-parents and we're business partners. So I will force them. If they're going to see me, they're going to have the couple talk times. I'll give them a week or two to get through the resistance, but that's so critical. And now I choreograph their talk times. The book will be very helpful. If they will go through these 10 essential areas, that is the basis of their initial couple talk times. I'll tell them exactly what to talk about. I teach the skill. They talk about what's going to block them, and they practice. It's ideal for that opening scenario, I think. Hey, you want to talk? Here's what you're going to talk about. Real issues, but short chapters and not like super, you know, super in depth, but you're going to get some breakthroughs.
Let's mention conflict. Some people have very little conflict. Some say none. When we talk about it here on Focus on the Family, some will write us or email us and say, you know, my spouse and I, we don't have conflict. And I guess that's a good thing. I don't know what they're missing perhaps in their marriage, or one person is always compliant, but I'll take it at face value, very low grade conflict. But speak to the other 99% of us who have conflict from time to time at varying degrees. What are some of the most common dysfunctional kind of conflict patterns that you've seen in the people that you've counseled?
Well, good question. And every couple, I think, just about has a dysfunctional conflict style. There is the avoidance. We both avoid conflict. We do not go there. Other one would be somebody wants to talk about it and somebody just shuts down. That would be the clam crowbar. Let's talk about what happened this morning. No response. You can't have a conversation when there's no response or I leave. There are yellers out there. They're godly people. They love Jesus, but they yell their heads off when they get upset. One yells, one retreats, both yell. Very common also is the illogical person, could be the man. Very logical. I'm making my case here. You know, F. Lee Bailey, boom, boom. And the woman is emotional, and so it doesn't work. You do that the same dumb way every time, and it doesn't work. That eventually leads to we don't talk about it at all because it's never worked for us. Now, in the book, I'll teach them just how to have conflict. It's a template they can follow. If they follow the rules every time, it'll begin to work. You can resolve any conflict.
Well, what are those? It's a seven-step approach again. I mean, the book is filled with great advice.
I have
very practical.
Yes.
So highlight these seven steps.
The first thing is you embrace the fact that you have this dysfunctional conflict style. We're going to do it. We're going to keep doing it. We can't stop it. When it starts, the first step is, okay, we're doing it. Somebody raises a hand, we're doing this. Second step, you have a place that you're going to go in your home that's going to be your conflict place. Never the bedroom, not the warm, fuzzy place for the conflict times. It's going to be a room you don't care about. Living room you never use unless Queen Elizabeth comes by, lanai, office, neutral sort of a place. Geographically, it helps to know that's where we do conflict. So we have the place. Now, once you know there's a conflict, you always schedule it. You don't launch into it because that's what's going to happen. You've already launched. You've caught yourselves. Now you're going to schedule it. And when you sit down in that conflict place, it's always and forever, one at a time. Jim, you and I are married. If you got the issue, you're going to start first. And my job, you're the speaker. I say nothing original. I listen and I reflect what you say. You want to feel understood. I'll be thinking, he's crazy. He's out of his mind. What's he talking about? Didn't happen that way. I don't share any of that because that would be a violation of the rules and we have lost the conflict. I listen. I reflect. When you say, Dave, you've understood me, take a little break, come back, the roles reverse. I'm now going to share my point of view. Totally different. Agreement is not the goal. You're never practically going to agree on anything. You're a man and a woman. We're looking for understanding. So it reverses, and then when I feel understood, we take another break. Then we move into most couples never get that far. Once we get that far, now we can talk about what are we going to do about this and come up with a solution. I have couples even post these rules on the wall in their conflict place. Follow those rules. What will save you too? One of the steps is, I call it stop and start. When you start losing the conflict conversation, despite your best efforts, you've blown it, you're starting to yell, I can't listen, somebody raises a hand, we have to stop temporarily. Always has to be honored. Don't overuse it, but when you raise your hand, okay, we're stopping, brief break, and then you resume when you both feel ready, and where were we? Try again.
Okay, that's good. Those are good tips. It's difficult because of the mechanics of it and getting into that pattern. As a person that doesn't fit into patterns well, I can struggle with that, having the notepad. Yeah. But it's helpful because it puts you in a routine that is constructive, not deconstructive, right?
And over time, here's the good news, you'll start losing the dysfunctional conflict style. You've starved it. You've not done it for so long. Now you're going to do it the right way, and it's going to work.
Okay.
It takes several months, but you get there.
And I think one of the things, David, we have to lift up is the celebration of marriage. You know, we talk constantly about what rubs the marriage nerve raw. Rather than saying, God has designed us this way, there's purpose in all of this, to be complete, to be one flesh, as the scripture says to us. And I love the solutions-based, maybe that's my guy thing coming out, kind of this solutions-based thing where this should work well. And if it's not, there's reasons why it's not, and there's reasons to make it work better. And this has been terrific. Your book is packed with great insights. Honey, We Need to Talk, wonderful title. But you mentioned the four-step solution to the clam crowbar, 10 things to get that conversation started for men particularly. Here are things you can talk about, and so much more. So thank you for packing it there. There is much more to talk about, so we're going to come back next time and talk again. Can we do that?
I'd love to.
Hey, I'm John Fuller, and thanks for watching. Get more info about Focus over here and more from our guests over there, and be sure to subscribe to our channel as well.